afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Geospatial Forum. I'm Ross Mintemeyer, Director of the Center for Geospatial Analytics, and I'm thrilled to host today's speaker, Dr. Falk Huitman. Pretty good?
Excellent. Impressed. Thank you.
Dr. Huitman is an Associate Professor of Wildlife Ecology in the Institute of Arctic Biology at the University of Alaska Fairbanks, where he's using a variety of rigorous spatial geospatial approaches to address pressing issues in conservation biology. We often cross paths at the annual USAALI landscape ecology meeting due to our shared interest in landscape and spatial ecology, and so it's really great to have you visit here with us today.
Thank you.
We have a number of students in that area as well.
Thank you.
Dr. Huitman graduated with a Master's of Science in Forest Science from the University of Munich, and a PhD in Forestry and Environmental Management from the University of New Brunswick. So today, using examples from both polar regions and the tropics, Dr. Huitman will share his work with us on machine learning-based open access data mining, the latest frontier in geospatial analytics and conservation. Please join me in welcoming.
Thanks so much. Thanks so much. Thank you. Thank you. I'm very impressed I may be here. Thanks for the invitation. That was very kind of you. So this is the title of my talk, pretty long one, and you see there a couple of things. One is that's open source. I think some of you are familiar with this. Machine learning, open access data mining, it's clear. The latest frontier is also clear in geospatial analytics and global conservation. But then here's actually something that's probably new to you, is that there is a certain science policy, a certain culture that doesn't allow us to reach real conservation. I will talk about this as a very important factor. As you probably can see in here, I'm born and raised from Alaska. Actually, I'm German. But I lived in Alaska for 15 years. So I work in wilderness areas, and I'm having a lab there called the E-Whale Lab. That's what the E-Whale Lab does, many things, including data mining. We work on land and seascapes and the atmosphere nowadays as well, and do many things there. And so I will talk about this lab a little bit, context and examples, and then a little bit about teaching, and then ask the question, why are we not progressing more than what we currently can do? I think you're all aware we live in globalization. It's the Anthropocene. Humans play a big role. They're the big drivers in this. That's reflected in many ways. For instance, these are some of my graduates, students there. I just show you quickly where some of them end up. This is, for instance, Johannes Rehfisch. He was with us in the first time as a postdoc, and he's now in Nairobi working on a great apes for the United Nations. The next person is Nikita Chernetsov. He is the director of the bird banding station in St. Petersburg, in Ribachi, and works a lot in Asia on migratory birds. Also was a postdoc with me. And that's Dirk Nemitz, a master's student. MGIS student, by the way, and he has worked for the German government and the EU in some climate negotiations in the Paris Agreement and also currently the Bonn agreements. The next one is Grant Humphreys. That's actually him. Actually, this is his son. But he was a master's student, comes from Canada, Newfoundland, then went on to New Zealand doing a PhD there, went to UC Davis in Rhode Island, and now is in Scotland where he works on penguins in Antarctica using remote sensing techniques. Here's Stefan Oppel, who works for the RSPB in England now on vultures in Asia, including seabirds. This would be Trey Hegel, a Canadian who is in the Yukon government, working on caribou. These are some Germans who worked on, as is a couple, they came and they work on lynx and forest planning in Central Europe for the European Union. Hege Gundersen, with her husband from Norway, she works in NINA on water issues, as a modeler. Just to show you that we are truly global, right? That's what we're trying to do. We live in a global world. It's not that I really choose to be global, but on the other hand, that's just how it works. This is a selfie, a science selfie project we did. We work on things. This is an Arctic bird in the Bering Sea called the spoon-billed sandpiper. There are only 1,100 of them around, probably. We have some work done there on machine learning wintering grounds. And what you see here, this is probably one of the hotspots where these Arctic birds hang out in Bangladesh. And Myanmar, right on the border, one of the hotspots for Arctic wintering birds, and we use machine learning. You get the idea. I mean, it's truly global stuff. So when I look back in my life, what you see here is my own profile. There are 62 locations where I have been on the ground many years usually, and where I've published. This is a very interesting profile to think about, how you can actually do that, and what's the gain, like what's the take-home message from so much study done the last 30 years worldwide. It's fieldwork and it's published with data. Compare that to one site studying that to death for 30 years and then draw some conclusions. I think you all agree that if you just would be in one place, you're missing out a lot on the spatial interactions, right? Without geography, you're nowhere. So here we have obviously geography. You would probably ask the question, well, how is it possible that you can do all this research? Like, what are you really doing there? And we do conservation, but we also employ certain methods. And that's what I like to present on today a little bit, is binary recursive partitioning. That's what we really do. Do you know what that is? Ever heard about that? You probably have, just in different contexts. So let me explain it to you. Let's say you work at a place and you have two species showing up there. This would be the Alaska marmot and the hoary marmot. It's a binary model. You explain where these animals live or where these binary events are occurring. So you have a certain set of rules to explain that one lives in the high Arctic in Alaska, the other one more in the southern parts of Alaska, and you explain what the justification is and what the drivers are. You can also have that as a recursive pattern and recursive explanatory variable. So you can have two populations there and one in the south, and then you have binary recursive models. And you can have many, many predictors to explain why that pattern is as it is. So the more predictors, the better. It's probably an interesting topic to dwell on later on. And then you can optimize these predictors, and that's referred to as boosting and begging. Perhaps you've heard about it. I will not talk too much about it, but this is a statistical method how you optimize predictors. Now, the elegant approach here really is, I'm always stunned by this, is that you can actually bring in other species. Let's say, how does bison contribute to explain where these other critters are living? It's basically what you refer to as a mixed model. So you can run mixed models in binary recursive partitioning, or you bring in the predator, the wolf, or even habitat issues. I mean, you can all capture one model. It's pretty stunning to think about this. So you want to predict and you want to generalize, and that's what binary recursive partitioning can do. As a matter of fact, this is how binary partitioning, recursive partitioning really looks like. These are the rules. It's called a CART, a classification regression tree. And the power here is that when you have such a worldview, how things split and how you can explain things, you break any linearity in the data almost. So correlations, autocorrelation, all this stuff is not a big issue for these type of things. That's a very old method, by the way, published by Leo Bryman, 84. Still not widely not so much used, but it comes as a software, and you can look at the rules, and you can have entirely, here's a bison model, here's the hoary marmot model, and here's a moose model if you wish, right? It's a very elegant way of dealing with things. It's a completely opposite what you're probably used to. So I'm very sorry that I have to show you now something that's pretty ugly. Are you ready for this? It's pretty scary. Are you ready for this? I mean, you should close your eyes and very carefully open them. So I count till three, right? Ready? It will be very, very bad. To show you a very bad thing. So one, two, three. There it is. This is the worst tool applied in the history of mankind ever, with devastating implications to the degree that people die. I show you that. So linear regression, right? Pretty clear. You realize quickly that most data here, there's no trend in the data except for these two. None of them fall really on the line except for this one by accident. And you're supposed to express this relationship in a formula. That is a formula, right? So there's an offset, and there's a correlation, a coefficient, and then there's the actual variable. The funny thing is, when you look in the literature, this is a dominating model. I think 90% of all what we publish is based on this, right? Except that in biology, at least, in almost all cases, I rarely see one, where people start to interpret the offset. What really is the biological meaning of an offset? Right? It's really hard to say, and it's usually ignored. People talk about significances. They don't know. They start to interpret the slope. The idea would be the world is linear. You know the world is not linear. And you know that the world is not one single predictor, right? There are many predictors involved in the history of natural history, for sure. So this is a really big problem. I will show you some examples. Here is actually somebody else who has said it much earlier before I did, McArdle from New Zealand, published in the Canadian Journal, 1989. And I give you the highlight here. In the abstract, he says, most biologists, they are fully aware that ordinary least square regression is not appropriate when x and y variables are both subject to random error, right? In nature, we have these type of errors, right? It's not appropriate for us to use linear regression in most cases. As a matter of fact, here's something taken from the text. In the I wish it were so land of theoretical statistics, there are many excellent techniques, I agree. However, in reality, either the data cannot be made to conform to the assumptions, or there's insufficient information for them to give a unique solution. Think of that, what it means. This means basically this tool you cannot use in real life applications, right? Agreed? So I give you an example of this. Are you familiar of the Anscombe's quartet? You've learned that. Okay, cool. I'm happy you did. Most of my students have never heard about this. So the Anscombe quartet actually tells you that there are several solutions to the same linear regression formula, right? So if you start to interpret these formulas, there are actually different solutions to that. The question is, if you are a wildlife manager, conservation manager, what solution do you use? Right, there's confusion. Even more so when you move into the logistic world, linear models, transformed and so on, there are several fits possible. And what you see on the left side is very typical and generalized linear models. You see here the data. They are not reflected, they're visually not on the line, right? There are many here on the other side. It's almost like an opposite fit. And you wonder like, well, that's your generalized linear model? Wow, there's something probably not really going on, right? I think it's pretty clear. So there's a lot of doubt in model selection. I give an example, bears, right? You're familiar with bears. Alaska have many, many places in the world. And there's the International Bear Management Research Association, IBA. When you ask them, do you have any experience in other models than linear regression, GLMs and AIC and parsimony, you will find this very few machine learners in IBA, I would say almost none. There's a journal called Ursus where you will probably not find any science done other than with linear regressions. In other words, this applies to many bears, including the Mongolian bear, the bear in Venezuela and so on. The bears get managed according to linear regressions. And I think it doesn't do the animals a good justice. Moose. Okay, big animal, one of the biggest in the landscape, occurs in Norway and in Poland and Russia, certainly in Alaska and Canada and so on. There's a journal for it called ALCES. It's also a low-impact journal like Ursus. And this is a journal that managers use to manage moose. When you look at the statistical side, you see there's very limited use of machine learning and data mining. It's still this concept of linear regression that animals would basically satisfy these assumptions in the parametric model, which you know they don't. So this is for moose and bear. It's a big issue, right? Tiger, okay? Tiger in India. I mean, this, you're talking now really big stuff, right? This is really relevant. It affects like 1 billion of people minimum. When you look at the techniques used, it's here described here. It's mostly James Nicholson's models and occupancy models, which are also generalized linear models, parsimony, and sometimes even p-values. I don't think that the tigers are really satisfying these assumptions in these models. I don't know how people really do that. That always concerns me. So there's an entire continent managed with these linear regressions, basically. You can go on and can say snow leopards. Here's the snow leopard image here. These are all the data that exist for snow leopards in the public, despite years of research. For instance, the German Development Service has a huge data set, but they don't put them in the public. And then people try to manage them, mostly with occupancy models. This is a big thing in snow leopards in the moment with camera traps. That is, to me, very doubtful that it actually will be efficient. Here's a good one on ducks. If you ever work on ducks, I don't know if you ever have. There's a whole group, and these are very relevant animals because they deal with wetlands, right? This is a good indicator species there, boreal forest and so on. We know that the declines, black ducks, when you look at how these harlequin ducks are managed and how they're studied, it's mostly based on the AIC model, which is a generalized linear model in most cases, mark capture, recapture stuff. There are some of the really relevant duck habitats like Yukon River, Minto Flats, boreal forests, prairies, Alberta and Dakota and so on. This is like North American hotspots for ducks. They're also connecting with Asia and with Europe and with Greenland. But when you look at the statistics, it's something like a statistical duck dynasty. It's a very limited approach to science and to statistics, how these data analyze. There's a huge opportunity to be more diverse, but in the moment, I really don't see that. I think it's a problem because it affects all of our waterland management and hunting too. here's an example, it's even closer to my heart, that is fisheries. You see here a paper published. This is a pretty interesting one. So let's spend a little bit of time on this. This is a big fishery here between Alaska and Russia, pollock and others, and they have a bycatch problem. There are many stocks in Alaska. Many of them receive federal funding, but they are not really fully assessed for impacts, which in my view is a legal requirement. So here's a paper that tries to do this, and it says it understands and addresses seabird bycatch in Alaska of a very complex data set. Right? We agree, right? This is bycatch, fisheries vessels, three-dimensional in time and so on. So they try to analyze this, and when you look at the methodology, you will not be surprised. GLMs and GAMs again, and let's see how it happened. How is it possible that this is addressed that way? Number one, you have a research scientist usually involved, like Ed Melvin, who is a world expert in bycatch, but certainly not a statistician. Julia Parrish, who's a professor at the university, and she's a supervisor, of course. And then there's a graduate student, right? And the poor graduate student, when I talked to all of them, I mean, I know them pretty well, Kimberly did the models, right? And everybody's happy, because the supervisor wants a student, the government wants the problem fixed, and the PhD student wants a degree, right? That's our model, it's completely fine. It's completely legal, there's nothing wrong with it. Then you publish it in a high-level journal, and the publisher makes some money out of this. That's our model, right? I call it institutional terror, you might call it something else. But that's what we do, right? I mean, this is the model, everybody does it, we're all used to this. But the point is somebody pays a bill, and that's the fish. Or the resource, right? It's to me an example how with statistical techniques we are claiming to solve problems that we actually don't. Because it's pretty clear that, and we know that from landscape ecology, Ross and I, we know this, when you deal with the data cube that is ecological and explicit in space and time, it's not parametric, there's no independence. It's not linear, right? The parametric assumptions don't hold. However, reductionism still drives the whole decision-making process. Bring it down, boil it down to one parsimonious factor using these models and these metrics. There are entire methods that use this, like RSF, mark capture, recapture, USGS, at least in Alaska, they use entirely the information theoretical approach, which is fed to them by some contractors. That's how we literally manage landscapes, entire, if not even part of the world, based with these methods. And in my view, this is very limited when it comes to and dealing with the true complexities. Now, the environment gets marginalized, we know that, right? It's in our brain, we get trained that way. When you take a class in Economy 101, which is capitalism, which most of us probably adhere to, you see, this is what you learn. Here's the households, here's the farms, the government is doing goods and services and factors for production, and where's the environment? It's not there, right? The environment is to be marginalized, that's the rule. We teach that in all the institutions, including Yale and Harvard, whatever. That is the global model, right? So no wonder that the environmental statistical side also is not taken so serious. It's a logical conclusion. Now, you can ignore the environmental issues, as many people do. I'd like to bring you home a topic that's closer to your heart, and that's cancer. Here, for instance, for breast cancer, 18 variables are known to be involved in breast cancer. How in the world will you ever solve the breast cancer problem with linear regressions, with parsimony, with experiments, only one factor, one by one? It's a complex disease, it's a very complex question, and you cannot do it with reductionist worldviews. That's one reason why perhaps we haven't done so much progress on cancer, I don't know, I haven't worked much on it. But it's pretty clear that this is a classic example of a complex spatial data, right? There's a spatial data cube. So just to show you that if you make it wrong, people die. And people do die. So here's some alternatives for you, just to think about. Let's say you take all the data on fisheries or on cancer or whatever you want to analyze, and you run it on a computer. This is the first computer ever created with a steering wheel here and a TV. But nowadays we have better ones, right, our laptops. And you just run it through, and you get a conclusion. And you try to avoid statisticians. Just don't involve them. Just run that on these things. And see what you get. This is called data mining, and there are papers on this. There are over 100 algorithms to play with. It's not only the linear regression, but many others. You can combine them in ensembles. Many other examples exist. So this is a very big, deep field to work on, to solve problems of relevance to mankind. You know that in the moment, there's not a single Russian who can beat these computers. At least not in chess. They do it in other things, but not in chess, right? And it's clear we humans have lost against the computer. The computer has outcompeted us in many ways. This is just a fact, and we should realize that. It's also true in Asia with a game of called Go, where Google DeepMind basically beats the best Asian Go player. So I think we have realized that. There's actually an interesting TED talk on this subject by Garry Kasparov, who is a chess player from Russia, of course, who lost against the computer. And here's his message. You can check it out on yourself. But it actually mimics what machine learners know. It's a machine learning message there, a very interesting concept to talk about. Why many weak learners make for a strong learner. It's a very interesting concept. We can follow that more. But this is one of the paradigms of machine learning. Now, here's a talk by Cathy O'Neill who talked about weapons of mass destruction, mathematical mass destruction. To me, that actually is a linear regression. We can talk more about it. But anyway, interesting concept. I think you and I will agree that even visual data mining, just looking at the data in an effective way, is a very good tool. It helps us. So here's a command I recommend to you called varclust in the MISC library by Frank Harrell, which shows you basically two things, the Spearman rank correlation and how these correlations are clustered. So it's very informative just to look at the data that way, very insightful. If you move further into machine learning, you probably sooner or later will run into Leo Bryman. He published some very exciting work. I'm completely into this. I think this is our frontier that we haven't implemented Leo Bryman yet. Here's what he says in this paper. The statistical community has being committed to the almost exclusive use of data model, frequency statistics. This commitment has led to irrelevant theory, questionable conclusions, and has kept statisticians from working on a large range of interesting current problems. Think about this a little bit. Basically, when you take a class in classic statistics, you get deviated in the wrong direction and you're not solving the problem. That's what he basically says. It's interesting. I had a colleague who just died recently. He said always in committee meetings that a statistician have hijacked wildlife biology, and he meant the frequency statisticians. In my view, you can use machine learning here to extract the signal from the data in a robust way and then have more time for wildlife management. That's my reply to this, and I think it's a great approach. You're familiar with other textbooks on machine learning probably by now. I promote here Jerome Friedman, Trevor Hesty, and Tip Shirani. There are many others. Simply because they worked on begging and boosting, which I think is a great technique, and some nice good books there to pursue if you wish. There are journals on the subject, there are conferences, and then here just to justify this a little bit further, I mean, Google is not using hypothesis testing or p-values or linear regressions to track your behavior on online website clicks, right? The pharmaceutical company doesn't use it much either anymore. And other industries neither. I mean, nobody looks at the U.S. Department of Homeland Security wouldn't use hypothesis testing to find out who's a criminal. I mean, they have better techniques than that. Same with Facebook. So you get the idea. I mean, machine learning is there and it's not going away. There are many other books. You can also do it in R. Some of you have probably doing a lot of programming there. I think it's good that we do that, except that R has some issues too. So what happens a lot is that we're doing R, right, pirate stuff there. And so my question, who's doing R? Who's doing this type of coding? How many R people do we have here? Okay, so it's like half, probably more. So from those of you who are doing R, who's a trained programmer? Nobody, right? This is the issue, right? I mean, in R, there's a lot of what I refer to as homebrews, okay? Very common. I think you are probably very qualified people, but I know people that are not so qualified and they do their own homebrews. And the problem is that there's no real reason to reinvent the wheel when already Friedman and Bryman have done their work. You should look into this type of software packages. It's very important, I think, because the homebrews are just basically untested. They're not certified. That's an issue. By now, machine learning actually is an old science. It's 30 years old. It's literally for dummies. I don't mean a bad way, but you see the books here. Same is true for data mining, right? I mean, there's no way around data mining anymore. It really is for dummies, and we are supposed to be smarter than that. So I think it's clear, right? I also believe that the frequency statistics school, that's usually what you get in your statistics departments, most of them at least, these nice gentlemen, they never used a computer really, right? They never developed a theory with laptops. Agreed? You're laughing about it. And so it's pretty clear, right? I mean, theory that was developed without computers is probably a bit outdated by now, right? This is Friedrich Gauss. He studied at the same university as I did, except I came 400 years later in Göttingen. You get the idea. I mean, here's R.A. Fisher, who wanted to show that correlation and causation are not the same. You've heard that before. And so he always wanted to prove that, that smoking doesn't cause a lung cancer. You know what he died of? Lung cancer. This is the Fisher exact test type of thing that you're using. So there are certain very dubious statistical techniques, including the Akaike one, who has probably never really used a laptop either. So there are some interesting questions in this. When you think about the school of statistics, the classic one. Here is actually the older one, that's called Bayesian, but Tom Bayes also never saw a computer. So when people talk about the modern form of Bayesian statistics, that's basically just attributed to him. But the problem with Bayesian obviously is that it has many very interesting concepts, except that doesn't predict well. And therefore you're running into some prediction problems. So that's obviously issue there. So when you look at, then, at machine learning, I show you some papers of the last whatever, 6-7 years we did. It's like 40 papers or so. And here you see the impact factors of these papers. And you see that there in biology, in natural resource management where I work, I don't have many of the high impact factors. They're a little bit, but not much. Mostly we're in the impact factor of 4 or 6 or 7. Landscape ecology, that's what Ross and I are doing, is certainly in the higher range here of 3.9. Like fisheries management and ecology is 1.3 as an example. ALCES, right, the Moose Journal, 1.1. The entire National Journal of Italy on Zoology has 0.9, right? I mean, it's pretty low. So as a matter of fact, when you look at the professional society journals, most of them are pretty low, which is an interesting thing. I mean, the professional societies should be leading, right? But the impact factors at least are pretty low. It's also true for bird journals usually. So anyway, there's an interesting question there on these impact factors and how it relates to real true meaning. I'd like to show you a couple of these papers just to put it in context. So that's an earlier one we did on avian influenza, one of the first global models on influenza. And it has used NIH data that we compiled and made publicly available. And then this has a dots here. And then we modeled that out. And in red, you see where avian influenza worldwide is supposed to happen. And nobody knew at that time that this is actually seems to be a northern region or this cold region disease, which people sound like, you know, so it's a tropical disease. But actually, there seems to be a big component going on here in some northern regions. And that conclusion was done with machine learning. And this paper obviously has done a lot of downloads. High citation. So machine learning has contributed to this type of data mining of these limited data in a generalizable way. Here's another one. This is one that deals with the seafloor biomass, global patterns and prediction of seafloor biomass. These are the raw data in red. And then we extrapolate that out to the whole seafloor, which is an area where most people usually don't live and cannot get to. So we use modeling. And then here's a pattern that was published in plus one. Fine, there's nothing wrong with it. But I've always pushed, as one of the courses here, I said, you know, you need to make the data available. If you don't make the data available, this is like a limited value because it's not transparent and not repeatable. So finally, people listen to us and they put the data out. So we put it supplement out a few years later, and that was the end of it. Last month, I got an email from Plus One, and it says, congratulations, this article is among the top one most cited papers in Plus One. And the only reason why that really is, in my view, is because we put the data out. Right? If you wouldn't have published the data, this paper wouldn't be so widely cited. But suddenly people really want to get the data. For us as a scientist, or for you as a person who has a career in science who wants to get cited, that is the success model. Put out the raw data, right? Or the modeled data at least. Here's another one in one of the Nature family journals called Scientific Reports. The title itself took us probably 15 years to get it really established as a serious title. Machine learning, breeding habitat of an endangered species in Tibet. And we can talk about machine learning here, but the real application is an application for conservation. So here's what the discussion reads, is that the GDP in the Tibetan plateau was 356%. This is the GDP growth. It's insane. And there's no question that then the GDP growth stays in conflict with endangered species. You can read it here, and with a crane. So that's basically a critique of the Chinese growth model, or the global growth model. And that's what machine learning was used for. If you're interested more on the methodologies, it has an interesting methodology because it deals with the Tibetan plateau. Here's a mega transect where we basically use citizen type of data. no good research design in a classic sense, then you model that out and then you do an assessment of the models with other data, and you can have a ROC and ASC curve to assess the performance. This is done with machine learning using the Salford Predictive Modeler, which in my view is superior to any of the other ones that I have ever used. It's my own experience. And you obviously want to have the best prediction. I mean, if you have a second class prediction, that model wouldn't be so good, or the conclusion wouldn't be so good, right? So you use these advanced machine learning approaches in a scientific way to draw these conclusions. If you have more questions about these things, we publish these type of papers, why to choose random forest as algorithm to predict a species, and here's an example. So anyway, this is in PJ, just to show you that there's answers to these questions if you ever have to argue this. Here's one that is an interesting combination of machine learning and open access data. Here we use the red panda data for Nepal, basically, and model them out for all of the Himalaya region, which is a big landscape, right? And it shows that there is not so much red panda habitat probably in China, we think so, and so that the red panda habitat currently in the current maps is overestimated, where we are showing here a more true estimate. And the Chinese government was not so happy about that statement. But we asked them, well, if you don't have open access data to show us, then it's hard to believe that. It took us 2 years to get this into this journal. I finally end up in PLOS One because the editors wouldn't go with that. They say, you know, you do predictions and this is not right in machine learning. What does it have to do with Red Panda? I think we really broke ice there. We really broke up and showed, listen, you can use that stuff for the progress of conservation, right? So anyway, open access in Asia is a huge deal, and many Asian nations have not done that yet. We put our data here in the library, in our own library. It's basically a green way of publishing data. We also do physiology. Here's an example of monkeys, because I'm a wildlife biologist. We work with machine learning on this physiology data. And then here is one of the classic population estimates. This is for bird bending data in China. It's a flyway between China and Russia. And birds are wintering in Southeast Asia. It's a massive flyway when you think of it. It deals with Vietnam and Thailand and so on, and the Yellow Sea. And we looked at this data, but it's a very difficult data set to deal with that the classic approach cannot handle. So we use a method called data cloning, which basically means you have only 22 rows, you repeat them, but have many, many, many predictors. So you basically, in a classic way, overfit the data cube. It's like an overparameterization of data, but because you use begging, and boosting, you can actually do that, and it gives you sound estimates. In this case, we show massive declines of the birds in this flyway, which is one of the few estimates ever has been done on this. On very limited data, extrapolating out, showing that the climate has certain impacts there and that the animals are declining for many years already. It's not only this one winter event, but there are many other declines since 2003, at least, as far as we have data. So with machine learning, you can get to these answers that are really relevant for China and other countries, of course. Here's one more applied again. It's about a crane. There's some crane species that are wintering in Japan and other areas, and they fly over to Korea. You know that Korea is probably a very hot place. And there are some crane species that have decided to winter right on the demarcation zone between the North and South Korea. We don't advise them to do it, but our models show clearly that they're hanging out there. And there are some other cranes that fly over North Korea and then go to Japan. The question here is, we know the distribution. What does a potential war or peace scenario, how does it affect the survival of these crane species? So this is the scenarios, and we come to some conclusion, what is best for the cranes? You can imagine what is best for the cranes. War is probably pretty devastating. But we cannot get this published. We submitted this to four journals, and all rejected it even without review. I don't know why that is, but so is life. But we currently have it reviewed with another journal. The bird journals have a hard time to accept those type of things because they don't know what machine learning is. They don't have reviewers that really understand what it is. It's true. So anyway, this is an interesting application. Here's another one, goes back to telecoupling, the Patagonian shelf, so that's the Antarctic. Here's the fishing statistics for the Patagonian shelf over the last 50 years, 60 years. And you see it's completely going up to the roof here. And here on this map, you see telecoupling showing where the fish actually ends up. So the Patagonian shelf gets fished, then the fish gets distributed to most countries who can afford it. In white, you see the countries that do not get the fish. They, by definition, have a food problem, and they have probably a poverty problem too. So if you're a landlocked country in Africa, you're out of luck. You're not participating here in the bread basket of the world, where everybody else gets fish. And you also get some countries that are sending the fisheries fleet there, so that's sending and receiving here. and then here the ones that have no benefit. And what we did, we take this map back, we model out we have the raw data where the fishing happens, and then we overlay the fishing with predicted seabird distribution. So we basically can tell you when that nation, like England as an example, gets a fish from the Patagonian shelf, where the fisheries effort is and how it would affect the albatross. Right? So machine learning helps us to extend this type of knowledge based on telecoupling combined with machine learning. So these are just applied questions. Here's probably one of the most relevant paper we ever did that looks pretty benign. It deals with data from Canada, Canadian Wildlife Service. It took me 15 years pushing, getting data out of the Canadian Wildlife Service on the Pacific coast. And finally, they gave in for whatever reason. And we got the data out. But the issue here is we use a survey method called distance sampling that some of you might be familiar with. And we couple distance sampling with machine learning to get predictions where the seabirds are on the water. This is close to Alaskan waters here. So that's offshore. The issue is that the distance sampling community is not into machine learning at all. As a matter of fact, they block it as much as they can, to our experience. It took us 5 years to argue with them that using this approach is useful. I think finally they gave in, and they also think that they see that the results as they are. So this is the best possible predictions, which, by the way, happens to be one of the biggest impact, an impact study for one of the biggest wind park farms that were planned. Finally, the wind park was not approved. But anyway, this is a major thing. The reason why it's a major thing here is that we show that distance sampling with machine learning is an improvement. The International Whaling Foundation Commission is using distance sampling, and they're using it in a way without machine learning. And I believe that our estimates linking machine learning with distance sampling will revise many harvest estimates worldwide and done by the International Whaling Committee. This has many implications, I think. I'm happy to take it to a test. But here we have the statistical test and the application. So I think it's clearly there. So I think many of the whaling definitions probably need to be reopened up, what's sustainable, what isn't. Talking about marine protected areas, here's an example, no machine learning, but just the data. This is the Ross Sea. Do you know what's special about the Ross Sea? Ever heard about the Ross Sea? It's the most pristine ocean probably in the world, the most remotest ocean that we can get to. Therefore, it's very little fished. But there is research ongoing. And so the idea would be it becomes a protected area. So we looked into what data have been made publicly available worldwide by people who are engaged in the Ross Sea. And we have this paper there showing what data is there and what isn't there. But this is currently used by people who might make decisions in Kemmler about should we do here a marine protected area or not. And how it's done. So that paper, this open access paper, is contributing to one of the MPA discussions and one of the biggest, probably most relevant, probably that's out there in the world because it's just such a pristine place. Here's actually a book we did compiling all Antarctic data we have in the world, we know of. There are many co-authors, I'm only one out of many, but I'm the only American one. This is interesting, right? Nobody else has contributed in the US in this book to make the data available. When you look at the data downloads, you will not be surprised that 80% of the data come from, downloads come from US. I think there's something funky in the way how the US is sharing data, certainly historical data. It's a big issue, I think. So anyway, adding to that discussion of open access data. We also have machine learning chapters in there too, but just to show you what data exists for Antarctica. We've published on these things a lot. We do it all the time. These are some of the books. Some of them are in landscape ecology. I can speak a lot about Central America if you want. I worked there for 12 years, and we have very similar approaches to at least to data access there. I show you a couple of Alaskan examples. This is a GAP project that you might be familiar with. You have GAP projects here as well. It's a very small paper. It doesn't have much impact, I think. But that's done by our team. And the contribution here really is that we have basically 360 species data compiled, which GAP projects do, is nothing special, I think, so much. But we also have GIS layers, and we have species model layers also made available in different databases, including USGS, and then also publicly here. And I call that improved governance through data. So by just making this data available, we make hopefully we'll have better decisions. It includes drilling in the Arctic and all these type of things. And then I show you some applications, how these data set can be used. So here's, for instance, one that deals with this idea of rabies. So disease modeling, you're familiar with this, I think. For Alaska, it's pretty new. It took us, again, 10 years, I would argue, to convince veterinarians to share the data. They wouldn't share these data. There are veterinarian hospitals and clinics, and we tried to get this data. It's not possible. So finally, we got them on board here, and we have future outlooks where the rabies probably will be in 50 years from now with climate change. This is the Arctic rabies. A specific one deals with Arctic fox and with red fox and so on. I think for forest inventory data, we don't have FIA plots as you have here. So this is probably one of the best approaches currently towards forestry using machine learning. So huge help there. There's a whole PhD thesis and papers published on this. And then certainly in Alaska, that's, we have climate change. I heard that in the East Coast, not everybody supports climate change as a topic, but we have it. It's there. It's man-made. And we have forecasts. So you see how it looks like. We forecasted in one chapter the outlook for moose, caribou, and black-tailed deer with climate change. So that gives you some estimates. It's done with machine learning and open access data as much as we can. Here's another one that I think is even bigger. It deals with the North Pole, it's the Arctic. There's an issue there with Arctic shipping. If Arctic shipping gets involved, here are some of the shipping lanes, the question is how does it affect animals? And to my view, there's almost no impact study done on this question. We found that really bizarre. So we take all the data, citizen science, GBIF, whatever is there, and we model that out, and we find that here in red and in orange, you see that these orange areas are directly where the shipping lanes have to go through if they want to reach the Arctic. Here's the Alaskan one, here's the Norwegian one, and there's a conflict. And I can give you the word that the seabirds will pay the price. I haven't seen any other data, like polar bears and so on, how that works out. But for seabirds, I can tell you, the conflict, if their shipping comes in, the seabirds will have to pay the price. Think of oil spills, right? I mean, here in orange and red is where the seabirds live, and there is shipping right there. That obviously is a problem. We modeled that out with open access data and machine learning. There are other non-typical applications. Here's one, for instance, where we model the sound, the soundscape. You can model out the sound. In this case, a big issue here is how do snowmobiles affect the Wilderness Act and the quietness in Alaska and other places. So you can model that with machine learning. It's the whole paper's there. Here's one on isoscapes. If you're interested in stable isotopes, these are expected isoscapes. They exist worldwide already, but we redid them locally for Alaska, and we find that they don't match with the global isoscapes. That's an interesting question, because the global isoscapes are not done with machine learning. So that's an interesting question there. Has many implications for law enforcement, for instance. Policing is very interested to know where, for instance, marijuana is grown. And these models can help you with this type of question. So there's some very interesting issues there in isoscapes. eDNA, it's a technique where you can basically show the evidence of an animal without the animal being there by just looking at the eDNA itself, environmental DNA. And we modeled that out as well. And we assess that with citizen science. So it's a blend of all the best data we have for Alaska. And there's a lot of controversy whether this patch is true in the model. I believe it probably is. But you also have to understand that eDNA is very sensitive to distribution. It could well be that the ducks are distributing eDNA. And therefore, this model is true, except that the frogs might not be. But anyway, that's open for discussion. Machine learning has obviously helped that discussion forward. We also have done code application, code development. This is done by a student of mine, Catherine Miller, shared with other supervisors in fisheries, where we do a multi-species prediction of many species all summarized in one model. So for rapid assessment, that is really powerful there. In this case, hundreds of fish species. It's so popular in the moment that we even have papers get rejected and people still cite them. This is a paper that got rejected. This is a global model on peregrine falcons with 104 layers, 104 predictors, right? And people really want to get the data. I don't know why it was rejected, so we're just resubmitting it somewhere else in a moment. But even that is very much in demand, which I find very peculiar, but it's true. So you're aware, most of you have probably similar things. If you look at your citations, this is a snapshot of 1 week in September, where we get our citations in 1 week, 29 reads from China, 26 US, 6 in Brazil, 6 in Singapore, University of Geneva, Sao Paulo, this is Spain, and here's the Chinese Academy of Science. We have a global impact with that stuff, right, one way or another. It's not like an isolated Alaskan thing. We do global science and they get globally appreciated. It's no surprise that there's a lot of demand in MOOCs. We have developed a MOOC, but I haven't found a taker yet. If you're interested and want to serve a MOOC with us, come to us and ask us. We have all the materials available. We just need an audience to teach it to. In the meantime, this is what I've did the last 3 years or 2 years, where I teach workshops. There's a lot of demand. People invite me to come to these places and teach on open source, machine learning, R, GIS, and so on. You see, it's a global audience clearly there, and people are very interested in many directions. We also actually publish on the science of teaching. So how do you teach open access machine learning? What are the problems? Where do you run into problems? So there are some references, and I'm happy to give you a list of these things that I just cited in my presentation, but you can look at those. It's a science about teaching. So back to the thing, you know, I showed you earlier this map. What do you do with such a profile? Like, what's the conclusion, really, if you do such global effort on the ground with machine learning and open access and so on? And I presented that recently in a TED talk, a TEDx talk. In my conclusion, we should move for governance into open access big data questions, run data mining with machine learning, and then put it in an ethical framework. It needs the ethics in there to come to a good stewardship of the earth. If you do that, you will see it's very similar what people have done in holistic analysis, or what Buddhists do, or what Mother Earth people do when they talk, when indigenous people get involved. This is basically, I think, a governance that I can sleep over. It's fine. I don't have any doubts that that would be a useful model for the future. So the question then is, well, why are we got stuck? Why do we have so much problems in the crisis in conservation? I can tell you my views and my humble opinion. Not everybody will agree with it. But we are running an outdated business model. We have a very poor reward system for what we actually get rewarded for, what our work is for. Why are we going to work every day 8 hours or longer? And we also have a devastating global governance that allows for a lot of destructive science. Where we do science, it doesn't really provide the progress. I see it very strongly. There's a lot of examples of being neoliberal, of being based on solely nation states. We have institutions that are so-called perverse in the sense of it provides efforts and initiatives that are counterproductive. There are many examples for it. It's called perverse institutions. We have a dominance of Western ethics, which probably isn't so healthy either. And then we have these professional societies that are, in my view, really not so super professional in many ways, right? I mean, machine learning is a classic example. So we have a cultural trap. It's clearly there. And here's one of those cultural traps. It's called sustainable development. I haven't seen any development that really sustainable, because you need resources to be development or to develop sustainable things, but you can't be sustainable at the same time. I think it's not possible. There's some very interesting things. The idea that you have a win-win situation to create profits and to avoid poverty, that in my view is not feasible. I don't know how people do that. So here, for instance, the United Nations, right? Number one goal, to have no poverty. How do you do that? I don't understand how you can live in a world without no poverty. It has never existed in the history of mankind. I think it's just not so serious. So anyway, we consistently miss these targets anyways, including the Paris Agreement, as you know. So that is to me a cultural trap. We need to do better than that. Now, when you promote this, you have a dangerous life. Here's from The Guardian. I have a track record of people that died when they promote conservation. And this is a record year, 2017, to be the deadliest on record for people who defend land, human rights, conservation, the atmosphere. This is a dangerous life we live, and I'm the first one who knows that. However, that might inspire you a little bit, is this idea that people might try to bury you, but then if you're a seed, you might actually grow out of it. So that, I don't know, but I found that quote somewhere, and I found like that quote. With that, I leave it there. I talked for 50 minutes, so perhaps we have 10 minutes time for discussions. But thanks again that I may be here. I hope you found it stimulating. And I think machine learning and open access in a transparent, repeatable way can be helpful for making progress in conservation. Thank you. So there are different ways and business models how you can make your data available. Scientists always are short of money, most of them that I know. And so they're asking for business models, how can I get paid for sharing my data? The very idea of sharing usually means that you shouldn't really get paid, right? You work on a public resource, you work on in a public institution, so why are you getting paid? So that's called the green way, where you take on the initiative and the costs to share information with your colleagues and with the world. Just to show you that in the US we have a Freedom of Information Act, if you're paid with public money, you're supposed, federal money at least, you're supposed to share it one way or another. If you work in Antarctica, there's an Antarctic Treaty from 1959 that insists that the information is made publicly available to the global community. So anyway, green way means that you are doing it on your own. That is probably not a really fair way in a way. So there are other ways. It's called the golden way of open access, where you basically get paid and where the institution pays you or the publisher pays you. There are certain models. And so anyway, that's the approach. But eventually it comes down to an ethical obligation. And in the moment, it's basically still very voluntary, although best professional practice asks us to share data. So that's what I perceive as greenway. There has been a lot of discussion, and there's a lot of movement on this. But if you deal with library people, they're usually very much into this, because libraries are the holders of the knowledge and of the data, digital data these days online.
So when you encounter, when you just talk, rather than having talking to grad students about the linear regressions, what do
Yeah, it's a very funny discussion. I'm just going through it with my own faculty for basically 10 years. And they're hugging the linear regression. It's a power tool. In the US, like probably anywhere in the world, we have a problem in teaching mathematics. So if you just have a little level of mathematics or statistics, suddenly you are a super powerful argument. You win. Everything is highly significant, right? This type of thing. And so people get really defensive. Some take it personal and say it's all my fault. Where it isn't. When you see the history of Leo Bryman himself, he was a statistician, and he was not happy with the statistical community because he ran in the same question, to the same question. So I learned this type of stuff from a person called Raymond O'Connor. You might have known him. He was in Maine, and he unfortunately died. But it's a pretty old discussion for over 20 years where people just try to hack their methodology and saying mine is better than yours. And then they get really defensive about it. But when you really ask students specifically, are you trained in statistics or in these methods? They say, yeah, I learned it from my supervisor, or I've taken a class, which is different than being a certified person who has worked on these issues for 10, 20 years, right? Let's face it, as a graduate student, you're pushed into this, and often graduate students take it on because it's just their expectation or their livelihood or whatever. And then they make some decision and they defend it. Sometimes not so very thoroughly. So if you go that route, I ask you to put many different methods on the table. Do a comparison between your linear regression that you're used to and that you really love, and do machine learning as far as you understand it, and do another approach, Bayesian or something, and see which one works out better. Just let's be open-minded. I have not seen people that, almost no one, who really went back to linear regressions afterwards. Because the machine learning thing is so, it's faster, it needs less skill. You can use it as a black box if you wish, and it usually provides you a robust solution. Not always the best, but so that would be my answer to this. I would not bring it home on a personal level. We get many personal emails on this and discussions. That's not productive. I mean, you need to see the history that, you know, this is just, I think we have, with machine learning, we're basically 20 years behind implementation. 20 years. And so if the graduate students are not taking on, it will be another 50 years because they retire when, you see what I'm saying? So I think we need to start it early. Yeah, that's my comment.
So you talked about the difficulties that you had with publishing certain stuff, and this is not uncommon in the science world, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
it's true.
So sure. They feel like they can't do anything. So my question to you is, going back to the business model of science that all go through and use,
sure.
How can we adopt that to include interdisciplinary science practices and make it successful?
Yeah, the interdisciplinary science one is a different question than machine learning, but let me answer three questions. Number one, the example I use with the lack of implementation of machine learning reminds me, as a German, on plate tectonics. Okay, if you apply to a position in the 50s, 1950s, and talk about plate tectonics, you probably would not get the job, because people say, there's no evidence of plate tectonics, plates cannot move, this must not be true. It took actually 30, 40 years in Russia until 1980, until people accepted that plate tectonics is true, and they say the shape of Africa and the shape of Latin America is completely by coincidence. Right? I mean, so we've seen this type of cultural changes in science, and it's usually driven by people retiring. That's the only way how change in science happens. It's that's where the tenure is actually very, very harmful. I'm tenured. But it's a problem, right? So that's number one. The other one is that we get rejections. I think in considering that we do conservation, conservation is time critical. I don't want to wait 30 years. I mean, I put my own life into this, right? But I think for the sake of red panda or whatever species you work on, we need to have that open scientific debate and show which methods work better. So that's for any journal. In terms of interdisciplinary, it's heartbreaking for me to see that we haven't done much progress for interdisciplinary research. And I say that because you see my problems. I can tell you my PhD supervisor, who comes from Oxford or Cambridge, I'm in England, already did interdisciplinary work in the 70s. It was the same discussion we have now. What I'm lacking is a good progress in the scientific model. The scientists really, when it comes to linear regression specifically, have not progressed since, I don't know, 50s? It's literally 60 years old. It's a quantitative model. Science, and certainly the statistical approach, is a ritual. Everybody has to do it. We know in our own day-to-day decision making, I'm not going to a bank because I've done hypothesis testing. Right? I'm not going to a shopping mall and buy apples because I tested both apple prices and I find a significant difference in buying oranges. I mean, we know we don't do that, but it's a ritual, and we are completely trapped in cultural behavior, and science is cultural, but that's where we get trapped. And then the publication, again, that's what it is. So that's my answer to that. But from a conservation perspective, it's really harmful. Right? Go ahead.
So one question I had was, you talked earlier about assumptions that go into a frequentist approach in ecological studies, mm-hmm. they're not met. Mm-hmm. So are there assumptions that become involved with machine learning?
I like to say no. Okay. If you show me, I believe you. Right? So the reason why I say that is, number one, machine learning is a very big topic. If you use ensembles, you can have many underlying theories, and you just see whatever gives the best prediction. If you follow Leo Bryman, it doesn't really matter what your model is, as long as it predicts well. So you can violate whatever, it's irrelevant because you're not interpreting the model. You're interpreting the model on the prediction itself. You can have a so-called wrongly fit model, like that's why I say the R-square, for instance, is meaningless. We find many examples where the R-square, which usually is used as a model fit metric, and if you don't have a good R-square or p-value, you can move on. What we're saying, ignore that. Let's get at the best possible prediction we can do, compare the two benchmark data so that you know you're not in the wrong world, and then interpret the prediction. It doesn't matter what you have here for assumptions. So the classic example to me is autocorrelation. You can almost, not always, but in many cases, ignore auto.